The 6000 XP is EG4's flagship inverter. Is that true? It's kind of what it feels like. It's a super popular, feature-filled unit, and honestly, it comes in at a reasonable price. So welcome back to the lab, guys. You know here, our opinions cannot be bought. We will have some links if you guys want to purchase this thing in the description down below, as long with some coupon codes that we actually have to help you guys save some money on the 6000 XP. You can grab it from Signature Solar, Shop Solar, honestly, wherever has the better deal. The 6000 XP is a super good all-in-one off-grid inverter. However, there are a couple things that I just wish were a little bit different, but we will get into those in a minute. First, we're going to hit you guys with a super quick 2-minute teardown in case you're not already familiar with the 6000 XP. First up, this thing weighs 53 pounds, so it does pass the tiny baby lift test. He thinks he can throw it all the way back to Texas, but in reality, it's actually super awkward to lift. This is a split phase off-grid inverter, so it doesn't backfeed the grid at all, and it can do 120 or 240 in terms of output. That output is rated for 6,000 watts of continuous use. It says it has a surge of up to 12,000 watts for like 3.5 seconds or something like that. And you're able to stack up to 16 of these guys for a total output of 96 kilowatts if you decide to expand on your system. It's rated to be 93% efficient, and it's got an 8,000 watt solar input. Some places says a 10,000 watt solar input. I honestly don't know which one's true. We don't have enough solar to find out. The screen on this guy is simple, clear, kind of a clusterfuck, but we'll get into that later. And then looking around at the rest of the build, on the side right here, we have the fans, which have a nice little dust cover over them. You have your PV isolator on the side, as well as a power button. On the other side, we got our three fans. You can see your output button, as well as the little Wi-Fi dongle. And on the front, we have a nice set of breakers. So you actually have a battery breaker, and then a load, grid, and generator breaker all built right into the front. And then behind the panel, you can see the inputs for all of the battery connections, solar connections, grid, and load connections. And if you go ahead and take off this little plastic shield, it actually helps me at least make a lot more sense of what's going on back here. You can see the other side of all these connections. You can see the wires running into the PV isolator. You can see what's coming out of the other side of the breakers. Overall, it's a pretty clean build. You also have your dry connections and your communication ports and everything shoved over here on the side. When it comes to the app for this guy, it's a pain in the ass. It works, but it's a pain in the ass. And the price of this guy is $15.49. It seems to be on a pretty permanent sale at $13.99. And we have a $50 off discount code, which makes it $13.49. Which is not a bad deal. That's like the price of two of these 3,000 yellow Pikachu inverters, except you get way more bang for your buck when you just buy one of these. When it comes to buying an inverter, there's some very important things that you need to check though. And first off is idle consumption. This says it's rated for about 50 watts, which is actually really good. We went ahead and tested it and the battery was jumping between 0.9 and 1.2 amps. So that's in and around the 50 watt range, which honestly at the end of the day is really good. That's less than the 3000 yellow inverter runs, and this is double the size. So when it's just sitting there on doing nothing, just supplying power to your plugs, it's not actually consuming a load of battery. You also want to make sure it can actually run the loads that you're buying it to run. So in this case, this says it's rated for 6,000 watts of continuous output, but it's actually two 120 legs of 3,000 watts. So all that means is that if you're not running 240, you're running 120. Each one of these lines can only do 3,000 watts. We went ahead and tested it. Once you go over 3,000 on either line, it does go ahead and trip the unit. So if you're doing a 120 setup, just be aware of that. Otherwise, you can run this unit at about 6.25 kilowatts continuously with no problems, which is really, really good. I always love running them just a little bit above what they're rated for to see if it can handle it. As soon as it passes 6.25, it throws a code and eventually times out. We did a couple surge tests at like 7.3, 7.5 kilowatts. It only lasts about 3 to 5 seconds. It's not very long, but it does have a pretty decent surge rating in that range as well. And this guy is also the first unit that we have had here at the lab that can actually go ahead and start this compressor we have. It's a pretty beefy compressor. You guys have seen us test some other power stations and stuff with a smaller one at my house, but nothing, not the Delta Pro Ultra, not the Anker F3800, nothing that's rated to start this compressor has actually started this compressor yet. And this guy went ahead and did so. Good job for you. It's like a 12,000 surge and then only runs like 3,000 once it's running. In terms of getting power into this unit, if you want to have it connected to the grid or a generator or something like that, it only accepts 240. I had it wired up for 120 when I first wired everything up. It doesn't accept it, and it makes good sense because you have the ability to run 240 out of the load center. So if you're only putting in 120, you're just destined for problems. You have to wire this thing up to a 240 volt source if you're trying to run AC power or grid power or generator power into this unit. And when it comes to pass through, it works for both AC and solar, which is really good news. So you can go ahead and completely turn the battery off, which basically means if your system is plugged into the grid or plugged into solar, and for whatever reason, your batteries are completely dead, you can still pass power through this unit to whatever devices you're trying to run, while at the same time using the rest of the power to go ahead and actually charge your batteries up. So we went ahead and bypassed about 2000 watts of solar and about 2000 watts of AC, and both worked perfectly. And the last thing is just sound. This unit is a little bit loud. I wouldn't mount it right beside where I'm trying to sleep. But the good news with it is it's only actually loud for like a really small amount of time. As soon as you're done beating on it, it kind of just, the fans turn right off. They don't stay on for very long at all, which is actually really nice. A lot of these other units try to cool down for like half an hour when you're done, which could be good for longevity, but I think this thing is just running pretty efficiently. The 6000 XP also saves you a ton of money when you buy it in a really sneaky way. So this thing has like the PV isolator right here on the side. It has all your breakers built right into the front. And normally when you go and wire up a system like this, you need to have a separate breaker and a separate PV isolator and all these things outside of the inverter mounted on the wall or whatever before the power actually runs into the inverter. So the fact that when you buy this one, you're getting all these breakers and disconnects actually saves you some money, and it saves you some space on your wall and just makes everything more convenient when you're actually setting up your system, which I really like. The low idle consumption on this unit is also really, really nice. It's like a pretty beefy unit to only be running about 50-ish watts of idle consumption. If you were to build other systems, like we always talk about getting the 3000 and then you can upgrade and have two, but doing that, you're running over 100 watts of idle consumption easy. Or something like this, you have the same output and you're only running 50 watts, which is just impressive. It's just a good number to be at. It's less than a lot of the small inverters. I also just like the 8,000 watt solar input. Recommends a maximum of 10,000. I think that's because by the time you actually get it into the inverter, you're probably only getting about 8,000 into here. But regardless, there's two legs of 4,000 watts of input, which is quite a good amount. That means if you actually have 8,000 watts hooked up to this, you can never use more than you're putting in. So even if you have this thing running 6,000 watts all day, and you're inputting 8,000, you're still gonna actually build your battery bank throughout the day, which is good, and a lot of other units don't do that. You're f***ed, kind of. And I also just like the filter on the side. Again, it's a little thing, but a lot of people don't do it. A lot of times you could see straight into the side of your inverter. With this, at least if you're in the garage, a little bit of a dustier space or whatever, you know that the inside of the inverter is slightly more protected by having an actual filter on the air intake. And the last two things, and the most important two things probably about this inverter, is it's super easy to set up. Everything is labeled very nicely. When you take the panel off, it makes sense where all the wires go. There's nothing hidden. There's no weird shit going on. You just plug it all in and you move on. The second thing is that when you call Signature Solar, you get this.
I'm good, man. I've got a EG4 6000 XP inverter here.
No,
it needs 240 to charge. Okay, cool.
We've actually mystery shopped them before, and turns out they're a pretty legit brand that stands behind what they do. When you order some products from some of these other companies, you get something a little more like this. If you ever need warranty help with a company like that, you're pretty much f***ed. It's always nice to know that you got a friendly Texan on the other end of the line when you need help with this guy. Right away, the pros on this thing outweigh the cons, but there is still a few things that I just don't like about this unit, starting with the screen. It just doesn't feel natural. I don't even know entirely what I don't like about it. It just feels confusing. I wish that, two things really. I wish that one, I could have all of the settings showing me what I want at the same time. So when you hit like the up or down button to change your little graphic here from showing you the voltage that is coming in from the grid to the kilowatts that is coming in from the grid, it also changes the screen at the bottom that tells you what your battery percentage is. So if you're looking to find out what the kilowatts are that you're inputting and you already had the battery on kilowatts, it's going to change the battery percentage just to show you the grid input. And I wish you could kind of fine tune all the little numbers and get them all where you want them instead of having to cycle through a million menu options to find them all individually and then take a mental note of them. That drives me nuts. And the other thing is just, it's not intuitive, especially I can imagine for people that don't mess with multiple units all the time. It's just like the settings and going through that stuff. If you don't have a manual on hand, none of it is intuitive at all. What's the difference between UPS and APL in setting 4, the voltage range of your AC input? Why is it not just in it, like, just you have a big ass screen, give us some nice legible English that just says, hey, what's your voltage input? And then in 120 or 240, that's it. Yeah, just like, it's just simple. Anyways, I didn't mean to rant about that, but I know that EG4 actually does listen to feedback, so hopefully we can get an update going here, yeah? The next thing that I don't like about this unit is the mounting holes. It's damn near impossible to mount this thing by yourself. Most units have a little top bracket like this where the hole is bigger at the bottom and narrower at the top, so you can put screws in the wall, then you just hang it on there, and it slides down, it's locked in place. This, for some reason, does not have that. This one, you have to put the screw directly through, it doesn't fit through and then slide, so it's 53 pounds, you gotta get it on the wall and fire screws in. It just doesn't make sense. It's not easy. You should only ever have to mount this thing one time, really, but it's still a pain in the ass. I also just wish these opened more. I mean, I get it, whatever, it's a little thing, but like they don't, it's kind of like putting the breaker all the way up, you jam your hand on the door. It's kind of weird. Like I want it to just yeet all the way up, but it doesn't. It's the small things. And the last thing is the app. I guess that kind of goes hand in hand with the screen. The app, like all these power station companies nowadays have wicked apps. They're really cool. They feel really dialed and designed and thought out. And the EG4 app still feels kind of like Minecraft. It's like opening Windows 95, like a laptop from when you were in kindergarten.
Yeah, you're using LimeWire, you're getting it.
Yeah, perfect. At the end of the day, if you're considering an off-grid inverter, even with the things that I don't love in the mix, this is still one of your better options, to be honest, hands down. It works, it's affordable, it's got good support, and it saves you a little bit of money with the little dials and buttons. And I do like it. We've been using it for a little while here at the lab, and it's a pretty good unit. So good job, BG4. We're gonna give this bad boy an 8.7. Fix the screen, great customer support. There's some coupon codes and links for you guys in the description if you choose to buy this thing. Otherwise, that is all we got for you guys. I'll catch you in the next one. Thank you so much for watching. Peace out and stay charged.